The Tom Woods Show, episode 1860.
Prepare to set fire to the index card of allowable opinion. Your daily dose of liberty education starts here. The Tom Woods Show.
Hey, folks, if you have had it up to here with the COVID irrationality, you are going to love my brand new free ebook, COVID Charts CNN Forgot. Pick it up at chartstheyforgot.com. Hey folks, Tom Woods here. Kathryn Huwig is with me today. She is just a hero. I devoted an issue of my newsletter to what she did at the State House in Iowa, holding up a chart. We'll talk about that in this episode, but just beautiful. And that was when I became familiar with her work. She's been doing excellent analytics on COVID, specifically in Ohio, but of course we're all dealing with craziness. So what she has to say extends well beyond Ohio. I tracked her down and decided I got to have her on the show. She's done such great work as a concerned citizen and a very informed person as well, which is more than I can say for most of the people worried that if you get in the elevator with them, you're going to give them the virus. And I'm just finished dealing with folks like this. But Kathryn has been absolutely heroic, and I am delighted to welcome her to the show. Her material you can find on social media. I will link to that at tomwoods.com/1861. That's probably the easiest way to find what she's doing. Kathryn, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
This is so thrilling. I was just telling you that I follow a lot of people on Twitter who have had some really good analysis on the virus and the lockdowns, the government response. But you, although you're on Twitter, are much more active on Facebook, and I just missed your work entirely until recently. And I ended up writing an issue of my email newsletter about this. And I, by the way, I was trying to find out who you were, doggone it. And then somebody, after I published the email news, I did figure it out. I traced it around. I did find you on Twitter. But I don't think you even have a profile picture on Twitter, so I wasn't entirely sure. But anyway, somebody tagged me in a thread over on your page on Facebook saying, Tom Woods just put you in his newsletter. Because what I loved about it was you went to the State House and you did the exact thing I want to do, which is you held up a chart and you didn't have any of the dates. So you could see that the numbers of ICU patients, but you couldn't see when the different parts of the chart had occurred. And you were saying to them, all right, well, if these mitigation efforts are so effective, and if leaving us alone for Thanksgiving and Christmas is so devastating, go ahead, pick out on this chart where the curfew was instituted, or where the businesses were locked down, or the mask mandate went into effect, or where Thanksgiving was, or Christmas. Go ahead, find it. Find it on the chart. And of course, you can't. And you darn well should be able to if they think it's justified to turn all our lives upside down. It better be pretty darn obvious, and it's not. And of course, that's the most devastating kick in the teeth to the so-called public health establishment there could possibly be. So that is awesome. And I want to know, how did you go from what we all were, ordinary citizens, in the beginning of March 2020, to somebody who goes to the State House holding up a chart demanding answers?
That's quite a question. Well, I'm a little bit different than most people. You know, most people, when they talk about what happened March of last year, say, you know, I was really scared for the first couple of weeks, and then I started, you know, questioning or whatever. They had a moment of realization. But my background actually did give me some kind of insight into it, because one of my majors in college was actually evolutionary biology. And I happened to take a course in the epidemiology and evolution of human diseases. So basically, what's going on now, but without the politics of public health? And I had left academia long ago because I didn't care for how it actually worked. So, you know, I'd already left that whole world and have a real job, normal job kind of thing. And I was one of the very first people put out of business by it. So when I first heard that Governor DeWine was shutting down the schools, I was pretty much instantaneously put out of business. And at the same time, I knew this made absolutely no sense to do. It was just, no, this is wrong. This is going to lead to really bad things, things we do not expect to happen or not anticipate, that the cure is going to be much worse than the disease. And so for the first few months afterwards, you know, I was watching on Twitter and hoping people would start realizing that this was all going to be pretty ugly. I had read the Imperial College model. I saw what was going to happen, which, by the way, we are still doing exactly what they were telling us they were going to have us be doing back on March 16th when Neil Ferguson put that out. We're still doing that, and we're still going along for years and years of this until enough people are vaccinated, which of course will never happen because we're going to have viruses that are immune to that vaccine. But anyway, so I was mostly just, you know, screaming at my four walls, watching people on Twitter talking about it and missing it and watching as what was going to happen, which is they start doing antibody testing. They see, oh, this has been around for a long time, or not a long time, but, you know, it's more prevalent and it's less severe than we were afraid of. And then I watched as the people who were saying that just got shut down. And I realized, oh, this is really going to go on. People aren't going to wake up. And so just lots of frustration, but staying quiet until early July. And early July is when the Ohio Public Health Advisory System came out in Ohio, which I refer now to as the map of fear. I looked at the indicators and I realized that the very structure of it was designed to collapse on itself come fall, and it wouldn't require any COVID-19 at all. No active symptomatic infectious COVID-19 was necessary for the map to go to the highest levels. And I realized at that point, if it didn't get stopped, we would be in for a world of hurt. So I started contacting my legislators. I started reaching out, trying to get attention, to get people to pay attention to, we need to stop this. We need to stop this now in the summertime before it's too late. And from there, it just kind of built. I just kept analyzing the data that kept coming out and eventually started my understanding Ohio COVID-19 data, probably I think around Halloween or so. And yeah, that's kind of the story.
You have a lot of engagement on that page, and people on that page just love you. You know, they really, really appreciate what you're doing. And I love that only recently did you even think to say, oh, by the way, you can support the work I'm doing. I mean, yeah.
I have no idea.
Well, that's tremendous. Now, not too long ago, we got word that Texas was reopening, like fully reopening, 100% everything, full stadiums, everything. Mississippi was reopening. Then in Connecticut, we heard not a full reopening, but a lot of, you know, capacity restrictions lifted, Maryland. So it was one domino falling after another. But in Ohio, your governor said something like, well, you know, look, we have metrics that we use and we're not just going to open up willy-nilly. You know, it has to be 50 cases per, I forget what the metric is, but can you talk about that in particular and what that means for Ohio's reopening, unless they at some point just ignore that and reopen anyway?
Oh, they're not going to ignore that and reopen anyway. The entire setup in Ohio is one where they're constantly changing the metrics, and it's Lucy in the football here. It really is. When we start succeeding at something, for instance, I don't know, how long ago was it? About 6 weeks ago, maybe a little bit more. He finally gave a metric for how we start releasing some of the restrictions, and it was about how many hospital beds were being used. And he was tying the curfew, the 10 p.m. curfew here, to the number of hospital beds used for COVID-19. And clearly they were expecting it to take a while to drop. And instead of it taking months or not happening at all, it happened so fast and the curfew disappeared so fast. And they clearly didn't expect it. And that's kind of what they're doing with this 50 cases per 100,000. So that is our new metric, where we have all of the mandates immediately disappear, which should make people scratch their head and say, this is kind of interesting. Why would it be, you know, 0 to 60 there? Why wouldn't we kind of phase in? If we reach this point, then we get this. But with the 50 cases per 100,000, it's again Lucy in the football, because in the state of Ohio, we do not count cases like other people count cases. We include everything, anything. We include antigen test positives in a very special way. Antigen tests are, of course, those rapid tests, those 15 minutes. And interestingly enough, our governor was one of the most prominent false positive antigen tests, and probably in the world here, when he went to meet then President Trump, and he got a false positive on these antigen tests. And with antigen tests, they should only be used when the prevalence, which is the amount of disease in a population, is relatively high and the person has symptoms or has an epidemiological link. And normally when we think of an epidemiological link, that means you have close contact with a person who has COVID-19, not in the state of Ohio. In the state of Ohio, an epidemiological link is the existence. If you exist and you happen to be in one of their high-risk categories, which would be if you're in a hospital, if you're in a healthcare profession, if you are a first responder, if you are in a long-term care facility, if you are a student, whether you're a college student on campus or off campus, all of those things are an epidemiological link to the state of Ohio. That is not how normally we look at it. But not only that, when it comes to antigen tests in the state of Ohio as well, they don't even bother with symptoms or a link anymore. They just say, it's a positive, it's a positive. You're a case. And we are testing. Ohio State, I believe they're at twice a week now with these tests. And this is completely against the manufacturer's instructions. It's against the emergency use authorization. It's against the FDA's warnings. It's against the CDC's guidance. And yet we're doing it. And we're testing and testing. And we're just getting false positives. Because we're testing so much, we cannot reach that 50 cases per 100,000. And unless we start limiting who we are testing.
Can you describe for me what are the kinds of restrictions Ohio is still operating under at this stage? Like, do you have a tier system like in other states?
No, there is no tier system at all. There's just restrictions. There's no getting out of them until we hit that 50 per 100,000. We've got mask mandates for everything. I mean, you are to wear a mask at all times, essentially. Businesses have lots of very specific restrictions on them, on occupancy, on barriers. We have the Liquor Control Board goes into businesses with any kind of liquor license, and they check and see how many people in the business are not wearing masks or are not wearing them properly. And if they find people who are not, whether they have exemptions or not, the business could get cited. They could get their liquor license revoked for this. There's just lots of those kinds of things. There are no tiers. There is no way out. And there really hasn't ever been a path out for us.
So I assume, does this mean that in effect, theaters are closed, the arts? I mean, I know that you can go to museums. They've got probably limited capacity, but I've been to the Cincinnati Art Museum.
Yeah, I mean, they're open, but mainly the biggest deal is with the masks. That seems to be the biggest stopping point here. I actually have a friend. He's disabled. He's in a wheelchair. He's very clearly physically disabled. He is not able to put a mask on himself, and so therefore should be under one of the exempt. I mean, one of the reasons why you don't have to wear a mask is if you physically cannot put it on or take it off. He, in the last 3 weeks, has been denied service at four different locations just because of these mask mandates, and they're getting more aggressive. I mean, I personally, I don't think I've been in a grocery store since probably early fall, when the grocery store I went to had police officers out front making sure that people were wearing masks. So there's a lot of that kind of... It's not so much that the state is fining us, but it's creating this atmosphere within businesses and within relationships where if you walk around without a mask, it is encouraged to deny you services, to basically ostracize you. And it's become just this social pressure that's rather scary.
And I think after we've looked at all the charts of experiences in various states, in neighboring counties, and we've seen the results when there are mask mandates and when there aren't, at the very least, we can say masks have been oversold in terms of their effectiveness. That is the very least we can say about it. We should see unambiguously on these charts a clear decline in the metrics if masks are as important as the CDC under Robert Redfield said they were. And we clearly see no such thing. And yet, this doesn't seem to faze anybody. Put two masks on now. You can't get them out of this.
Yeah. I mean, in Ohio, I don't know what it is in other states. So, but in Ohio, we have, right now, we have twice weekly press conferences from Governor DeWine. And I would love to get the opinion of people who've studied marketing and all that kind of stuff, or psychology as well, because it's just, it's amazing the repetitive nature of these press conferences where they talk about the power of the mask. And we know the mask works because it works. And it's phenomenal. I mean, that's actually where my whole testimony came from, was watching these press conferences and having them say, oh, this virus is so unpredictable, but we know the power of the mask. I was staring at that chart that I held up and I was, of course, screaming at my computer saying, no, it's perfectly predictable. I can predict it right now for you. What's going to happen next? And the masks have done nothing. So we have this, I think it's a lot of just this people on repeat. The experts just keep saying the same thing over and over and over again. And so it must be right. And no one wants to go and dig in and do that extra effort. They just say, well, you know, I can't go shopping. I can't go to art museums. I can't go do anything without a mask. So, you know, shrug your shoulders, wear the mask. It'll make them happy. And eventually this will all end. But I mean, I don't believe it really will. I mean, the masks are just the first part of just it's just going to get moved over to the vaccines. We already see it now in Ohio. I believe there are about 2 million people in Ohio who have started at least getting vaccinated. And there's already more and more social pressure for people who can access the vaccine that why haven't you? And it's frightening. I mean, it really is, especially when you have that situation. Like my friend, he cannot wear a mask and yet he is being denied service.
Yeah.
So what is going to happen when we move along to this vaccination? Here we have this impossible to reach metric. Well, it's not impossible to reach, to be fair. What would make it possible to reach is a reduction in the number of tests. Well, who controls the number of tests? It's the providers. It's the state. We have pop-up testing sites. If they decide to reduce the number of tests given, suddenly we get closer and closer to 50. But what happens as we move through the summer? If we don't reach 50, people are going to get angry at people who aren't vaccinating. There will be more pressure. There might be businesses who have been encouraged by the mask mandates to start more aggressively pushing for this vaccination. And that's another reason why I've really been involved in all of this, because that's not okay, that kind of social pressure.
On the mask thing, you know, I started at one point on Twitter trying to explain to somebody who was saying, well, why are you so against masks? You know, are you that concerned about your so-called freedom? And I thought, all right, you know what? I'm actually going to try to engage this person. Why not? And so then I started to explain the importance of being able to see people's faces. And I realized, I can't believe I'm in a position now where I have to explain the value of seeing people's faces. Then I thought, I'm not even going to do this. Like, if I have to explain. But one concern that I've had has been, because at first I thought, by the way, that maybe the masks will be our way out of this. I'll admit that I wasn't that worried about masks. I didn't say that much about masks in the beginning because I thought, well, maybe we wear masks for a couple of months and that helps. So now that I've seen that, obviously that doesn't do any good. I mean, I think that's obvious. We should be open-minded enough to say, okay, it clearly doesn't do any good. I've turned more against them. But one of the points I've made is that we know from child psychology that infants depend very heavily on facial expressions.
Yes.
The mother needs to smile at the infant. Now we have babies growing up who for a year have lived in a world where all adults appear to have no facial expression whatsoever. That's not normal.
Yep. And not only that, I mean, it's not just with children. I mean, it's also with the adults. I mean, that was one of the big reasons why I was so, when the mask mandates first came in, I'll say it outright, I'm very opposed. I do not wear masks except if I am absolutely, absolutely required to, because it's not just about the children. It's also about us, because when you cannot see a person's full face, it's instinctive in us to feel anxiety. So at the beginning of the whole mask mandate, when everybody was forced to wear these masks, it's literally in your face that you need to be afraid, you need to be concerned. And then you look around and people's faces are concealed. You have this low-level anxiety at all times, which of course makes us more susceptible to being more afraid. And so you get this psychological cycle that, again, it just keeps leading to where we are right now and this dehumanization of other people where we no longer see them as human beings, but just as somewhat as obstacles to us having the freedom that we once had. And that causes people to do things that they otherwise wouldn't and don't think about the consequences of their actions.
I don't want to have the conversation, just because I've had it with every single guest on this, about how shocked I am that more people aren't outraged by what's going on. I think we all are frustrated about that. But what I guess I'm having trouble figuring out is, suppose Texas, in spite of, you know, if it really is the case that COVID positive people are coming over from the Mexican border, that could complicate things a little bit. But supposing nothing really goes wrong in Texas, and I know that cases as a metric is silly, but it is true that over the past 2 weeks since Texas took the mask mandate off, cases are down 33%. But the fact is, if cases had gone up 33%, we'd never hear the end of it, of course, right? That would be because the people weren't wearing masks. They go down 33%, it's just absolute crickets. But suppose Texas's reopening occurs with no obvious catastrophe. Florida continues no obvious. Florida's at number 27 at deaths per million. California is number 28. You can't do anything in California. You can't do whatever you want in Florida, but you can do pretty darn close. At some point, wouldn't you think some people in Ohio would say, well, these people are living okay, and they don't wear masks, or they can have full capacity at events, and you know, maybe they've started even to take the stupid stickers on the floor off, telling you where you're supposed to stand. How come we can't have that? Why won't that happen?
I think the people who are saying that have been saying it for a while now. It's the people in the middle. I mean, in Ohio, we're just very nice people. We're very polite. We, you know, we'll do things for others just to be polite. And, you know, you wear the mask so that people don't get upset at you and out of respect kind of thing. And we pay attention to our own lives, right? And I think the people who see, hey, Florida's open, hey, Texas is open, they see it, they get it, they stand up. There are quite a few people who are saying this is ridiculous, why are we doing it? But then there are a lot of people who just, you know, they get their news from the evening news and there are commercials on TV in the state of Ohio just constantly. They are constant and they are, you know, dripping with fear. Health professionals talking and crying on these commercials. And now there's a lot more about, oh, well, the vaccine is here. We can care for each other by taking this vaccine. There is no acknowledgement of what's happening in states that have removed the mandates. It's like it doesn't even exist here. It's a bizarre world, and it's really appreciated, at least from my perspective, whenever people in those free states post videos, post pictures, show us, because we don't see it here. It doesn't exist.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good point, because I'm fortunate to, in fact, live in Florida. And we moved here back in 2016, not knowing obviously what was going to happen. So that was really a fortuitous decision, because thank goodness we're here. Because I have five daughters. I don't want their lives ruined. I don't want wonderful memories that they could be making taken away from them. I'm very lucky to live here. And doggone it, through this whole thing, I've traveled to the extent that I possibly can. I was just in St. Lucia, so I even left the U.S. I've been to the Virgin Islands. I've been all over the U.S. And I've gotten to see different regimes. The most open one was South Dakota. I saw the fewest masks there. Saw a lot of masks even in Wyoming, but that was in Jackson where all the elites settle. So, of course, naturally, they're all going to do their thing. But I've done my best to try to live my life because I feel like this is they're taking away from us a non-trivial chunk of our lives, and I don't consent to that, especially now that I see that there's clearly no connection between social mobility and health outcomes. There isn't, so it's not even doing any good. And secondly, the selfishness that we're accused of, it seems to me, is on the other side. I'm not being selfish by wanting to do things that come naturally from human nature. What's selfish is demanding that I not be able to do things that bring me joy, not be able to do things that bring my children joy, not be able to pursue the things that make my life worth living. How did our words get so redefined that that's not selfish when, to my mind, it certainly is? I mean, I suppose that's more of a rhetorical question than anything else, but I'm sorry, when I have these conversations, I can't stop ranting. It is physically, and it's an impossibility for me.
Yeah, I mean, one of the most frustrating things to me, it is this abusive language that we're living under here. I mean, I don't know what it's like in Florida. It sounds like it's like heaven compared to here, but the language that is used up in Ohio, it's stunning. And it's just, they're trying to guilt you into it and that you are a bad person. But here I sit here, I mean, the crazy part is I actually had it. I had it last February for sure. I mean, it was, I had every single symptom. I had the fever. I had the loss of smell. I coughed, a dry cough for over a month. I mean, it was uncontrollable kind of cough. I couldn't catch a full breath for probably about 5 months. But here I am. My entire life has been restricted. I'm not able to work. I'm not able to go out. I'm not able to live. My children can't have the normal things that they had before. And yet we don't acknowledge this basic fact. I'm immune. I had it. I should be able to be part of society, and I'm not. And there's no acknowledgement of that. And it's all about the vaccine. And it's frightening. It's really frightening how we just have stepped away from everything we have known to be true in how viruses work. And I don't know how we stop people. I mean, we have to get them, people who are not paying attention, and maybe even some of the people who are kind of on that frightened side, to stop and think. But you can't make them stop and think by just using logic. You have to use emotion. You have to grab them by their emotions, either with stories. There are so many stories of people who are absolutely suffering and devastated by these shutdowns and restrictions, losing their lives. And we need to grab people by that. And we need to grab people the way I tried to show in my testimony, which is you create such gigantic cognitive dissonance. You just shake the person somehow. Because we can talk all day about, well, look, this is obvious. You can see it. Come on. But when people are afraid, they don't think rationally anymore. And we just need to find, all of us need to find ways to emotionally jar people, like pictures of Florida and people gathering in great numbers and being normal. Or hey, look at this. Now tell me, do you see? Can you show me where these things happened? Or stories where one of my friends that I've met through all this, one of the most incredible people I've ever met, her husband has ALS. And when Governor DeWine shut everything down last year, overnight, she lost all of the services for her husband, all of them. She had over 40 hours of physical therapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, in-home nursing care, all of these things. And overnight, when Governor DeWine put in his mandates, he also took all the funding from neurodegenerative diseases for in-home care. And she was left to care for her husband with ALS. And then he, despite them, you know, completely isolating, he got COVID and she didn't know it. And she thought it was aspiration pneumonia. And they eventually tested him and his test came back positive. And this is weeks after he was sick and finally managed to, he pulled through. She got a care package with a body bag in it.
Oh my gosh.
And these are the stories that are happening here. And here we are a year later. He still has no in-home care. I mean, this particular story, her name's Carrie Benton, and she's been out there. And I actually have an interview with her on my group page. And it's just, you listen to these stories and it doesn't seem real, but it is real. This is really happening. People are hurting this way. This is not, you know, just, I don't want to wear a mask. There are serious issues going on here and complete lack of humanity. And those kinds of stories need to be told. And that's what I'm trying to do. Because I also don't have my personal group page where I look at the Ohio data. I'm also working with a number of other Ohioans who have the same thing. And we actually have something called the Ohio Post-Depressor, where after every one of Governor DeWine's press conferences, we get on and we have a panel discussion about what he's talked about. And we try to pull on people with these kinds of experiences. We pull on business owners. We pull on people with knowledge of the politics. And we talk about all of this stuff to try and create that counter narrative. So, I mean, we're trying, but we need to get people by their emotions.
Well, I agree. And this is why I personally think, especially given we're living in 2021 and the technology is amazing, we need a documentary filmmaker to be immediately at work on this. This should have started 6 months ago. But not just telling the stories, also the charts. Overlay them with the charts combined with the statements of public officials and show how contradictory they are to each other. And ever since your testimony where you held up that chart, I got the idea that what would also be nice would be to do more quizzes. Okay, here's a chart depicting 10 Midwestern states. One of them lifted restrictions a month ago. Can you tell me which one? And of course, all the lines are the same. Or here are two states. During a recent spike, one of them closed indoor dining. One didn't. Can you tell me which is which? And I want them to keep scoring zero. Zero. If they keep scoring zero again, I mean, I don't know about you, but the prospect when I was in school of getting a zero on something would fill me with terror. And maybe that visceral response is still in some people. If they keep getting a zero every single time, doesn't this eventually, again, I know this is a rhetorical question and that's a terrible interview tactic to throw over, but I mean, doesn't that eventually cause you to make some progress? You can't get any of it right because no one can tell the difference.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that the people who are driving this, I don't think that they're going to have some kind of epiphany at some point. But I think, yeah, if you embarrass them enough, one can hope that they start reacting. Maybe not in the way you might hope that they do. I don't know. Actually, did you actually see the rest of my testimony that day?
I saw only the 2 minutes, I'm sorry to say.
Oh, no, that's not a problem. So, yeah, this is kind of funny. This is actually the second time that I testified in front of the State House. It was the exact same committee I testified in front of 2 weeks prior for another very similar bill. This is a bill to establish a legislative oversight committee, one that would be able to, you know, call the experts in front of them and say, okay, explain yourself to us kind of thing. And 2 weeks prior to that, I gave testimony talking about the Ohio data and how corrupt it is, that it's filled with nonsense. We had, at the time of that testimony, 16 post-mortem infections.
Wow.
So they died, and then they had onset of symptoms, according to Ohio's data.
Now that's some science right there.
That's some science right there. I mean, this is it's amazing. I mean, you look at, and we had, there was a hospitalization that occurred in 1974. I mean, this is super basic. Okay, this is an entry error, but is no one looking? And then if you work out just in terms of, does this make sense? A game of, does this make any sense whatsoever? For instance, we have hospitalizations where the person had onset of symptoms in March, and were hospitalized in November for COVID, hospitalized for COVID. According to our database, that's what they're saying. And it's like, no, that doesn't make any sense whatsoever. This is illogical. 44.1% of our hospitalizations were like that. And if you look at the deaths, more than 50% were never hospitalized. How does that work with an acute respiratory virus? Why are they not being hospitalized? What is going on? Are they really, you know, sick with COVID? Are they in hospice? What is going on? And if you add up all the incongruities with the deaths in the state of Ohio, over 75% of them don't make sense just from the data that they give us. And so I testified about that 2 weeks before that particular testimony, and they responded to me. It was the first time they ever reacted to me. But 1 week later, they had fixed 11 of those postmortem infections, and then they changed the way they counted deaths. And when they changed the way they counted deaths, they also disconnected the date of death from the onset date and hospitalization date. So all the things I could look into and say, hey, well, that doesn't make any sense, that all vanished. So the first half of my testimony that day was saying that the Ohio Department of Health had solved the problems that I had brought to light 2 weeks prior simply by erasing it.
Well,
okay, well, that one.
Yeah, look, we had some issues in Florida when it came to deaths too, in the just in the sense of getting a sense of when the deaths occurred, because they would add them so late, it would distort our perception of what was happening. So we have the heroic Jennifer Cabrera, who would catalog these deaths every day and say, all right, we've got changes going back. Some of them would go back 6 months. They'd say, oh yeah, that was a COVID death. And then it would be reported on a particular day 6 months later. It was very strange. So, but maybe not quite what you guys are facing there. Now, even though you're reporting on Ohio, I mean, a lot of what you're saying is generally applicable, because we're dealing with crazy people imposing crazy restrictions. And I'm not in Ohio, but I'm in your group because I want to know what's going on around the country. So I'm going to put links to you on Twitter and to your Facebook group on the show notes page, tomwoods.com/1860. That's 1860. But do you want to just tell us how to reach them also here on the podcast?
So I am very much on Facebook simply because I cannot limit my characters. I find that very annoying. I'm not a big fan of Facebook and their, you know, restrictions and stuff, but I can at least write a lot on Facebook. And I am at Understanding Ohio COVID-19 Data on Facebook. And I have a wonderful person who is also transferring all of my extremely long Facebook posts over to Twitter. And that is at @Ohio_data on Twitter.
Okay. So as I say, I'll link to these places where people can follow you at tomwoods.com/1860. Well, thank you very much for what you're doing. We all appreciate it. And as I say, I was so glad to see you have raving fans, because you absolutely deserve them. Even if all you did was that 2 minutes, you deserve the raving fans. But now that you post a lot and you're really careful and meticulous and passionate, exactly the kind of person we need in every single state. So thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
All right, folks, that's going to do it for today. Tomorrow, our old friend Mark Morano returns to the show. He's got a brand new book, Critical of the Green New Deal. Much more critical of the Green New Deal than, say, your average newspaper editorial writer. Obviously, the Green New Deal needs to be smashed as hard as possible, and that is what we intend to do. So if you have not yet made The Tom Woods Show part of your daily routine, join the many tens of thousands of folks who have already done so over at tomspodcast.com. See you tomorrow.
Become a smarter libertarian in just 30 minutes a day. Visit tomwoods.com to subscribe to the show for free, and we'll see you next time.
Like the sound of The Tom Woods Show? My audio production is provided by Podsworth Media. Check them out at podsworth.com.